It is the touchline here on Y254. You have been watching the Bayern Munich national anthem as they won the UEFA Super Cup and start their season on a high. And also, what a good way to start this afternoon here on the touchline, because it is 3 minutes to kick off in the game between Brighton and Manchester United. Joining me here to discuss everything on the fan zone is Eric Aganya, who is a sports analyst, and also Joe Saina, host of Joe's Dugout Football Podcast. He's here today with us to discuss everything that is going to be happening. We want to start with a bit of a preview of the UEFA Super Cup, but let's just jump in with the game that is going to be happening this afternoon, as the lineups are already out. Brighton defeated Newcastle last week by 3-0, and now Matt Ryan started in goal. A back three of Ben White, Adam Webster and Lewis Dunk is in that. And then you've got four midfielders there. Tariq Lamptey, who was the bright star of Brighton last weekend against Newcastle, starting us off there. Adam Lallana makes his first start for Brighton. And then Steven Alzate and Salim March finish off the midfield with a forward line of three: Aaron Conley, Neil Maupay and Leonardo Trossard, as Brighton wish to take on Manchester United in the early kickoff. Joe, big conversation coming up with this game. Let's just go into it and say, what do you make of the game, this early kickoff?
I think we were talking earlier and we agreed that Solskjaer went back to his original team that won him games last season.
Yes.
But I guess the big argument would be the inclusion of Lindelof. Mm-hmm. And again, we were talking about it, saying it's two ways. The pressure on him, mm-hmm. but yet he's still a good defender.
Yes.
He can still defend. Mm-hmm. The problem is, as you had rightly put out there, is that he is not playing with an experienced defender, mm-hmm. who can actually tell him, you know what, when I go forward, you remain behind.
Yes.
Because again, if you look at their gameplay, they are very slow. Mm-hmm. Maguire and Lindelof, very slow. We saw what Zaha did last week. Mm-hmm. So it is up to now them to understand the communication between Maguire, Lindelof, mm-hmm. and Matic,
yes.
for this game. Because Mopley likes playing behind the line. Mm-hmm. And he's a very quick player. Mm-hmm. And if he is a one-on-one with Lindelof or with Harry Maguire, there will be a problem.
Yes.
If you look again at the creative prowess of Adam Lallana, mm-hmm. that's someone that needs to be stopped, because yes. once he starts getting those balls into the front three, mm-hmm. it will be a problem for United.
Yeah.
Because we know very well that Bissaka and Luke Shaw will bomb forward. Mm-hmm. So they will leave a gap behind. Mm-hmm. Matic needs to stay behind.
Yeah.
To cushion and to buffer Maguire and Lindelof.
Yes.
That is very important.
Eric, big one there from Joe, as he has actually put it. But now Manchester United, sticking with the lineup that they had, off the mic, you were talking about United sticking with the squad that they had last season. And people are talking about a lot of pressure being put on Victor Lindelof, and it's just one game. What do you make of the lineup? Lindelof comes back with Maguire and Luke Shaw in that defense. Matic makes a comeback onto the squad, but Solskjaer goes on with five midfielders and then Antoine Martial to be the one pinpoint striker at the front. What do you make of the chances of Man United this afternoon?
The chances of Man United, Robert, are good this afternoon, because if you look at that team, there's more balance than the first game we played.
Yes.
Because when Matic comes into the team, he changes everything. He has the discipline to shield the defense. He's not
yes.
tempted to really move forward. Mm-hmm. Unlike McTominay. McTominay is good, but he has a tendency of rushing forward and then eventually exposing our central defense.
Yes.
Because the problem with Lindelof, as Joe has said, Lindelof is a very good defender. The problem is that he's playing with a defender whom they have the same attributes.
Yes.
They are both slow. Mm-hmm. They are both, I'll put it in quotes, poor readers of the game. Because you find that if you look at the first goal we conceded against Crystal Palace, they were both pulled to one wing. A cross comes in, it has exposed the central defense.
Yes.
And being slow, both of them, then nobody is able to complement the other.
Yes.
But today, at least I'm happy that Matic is in.
Yes.
Because Matic will sit back and shield.
Yeah.
At one given time, we've seen Matic being used as a centre-back by Jose Mourinho.
Yes.
In Chelsea.
Yeah.
So he has that discipline.
Mm-hmm.
He can sit back and allow the other midfielders to bomb forward.
Yeah.
Another attribute, if you look at that team, Solskjaer has gone for the policy of we will attack you so that you fail to come to us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he's banking on.
Yeah.
And that's what you see, he has brought in young guys who are very fast to come to you so that you don't come.
Mm-hmm.
And if that is, we're able to execute that properly, then Manchester United should carry the day today simply.
But also, if you look at that midfield, what happened against the Crystal Palace game? They broke the chain of communication between the midfield and the attackers, so much so that those passes are not going to the attackers.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something, if Brighton can watch that, if they watched the game against Crystal Palace and realize that if you break the Manchester United midfield, there is no communication going forward.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, Bruno Fernandes is a brilliant passer. Mm-hmm. Low passes, high passes, corner passes. But if he is marked tightly, there's no way Martial is going to get that ball.
Debut for Van de Beek, came off the bench, scored in the first game for Manchester United.
It's a good way to debut, but we still need to see his passing prowess.
Mm-hmm.
He was brought into Manchester United to provide those passes that can lead to goal chances or even goals themselves.
Yeah.
Yes, he scored, but give him a full... This should have been a game to introduce him to the Premier League.
Full game.
A full debut, you understand?
Yeah.
Introduce him to the Premier League game.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you look at Chelsea, for example, Kai Havertz scored in the middle of the week, during the Carabao Cup.
Yes.
Introduce these new signings, okay? So that at least they can get the feel of the game. Because it's different being a good player in Ajax.
Yeah.
In that league, and then coming to the Premier League and also saying that you'll be a good player and you'll play to the system.
Mm-hmm.
You need to be in the system first of all.
I
think what the coach is trying to do also, he's trying to protect Van de Beek from the English press.
Yes.
Because if you bring him too soon and he doesn't perform, the pressure on him will be so high that he will not be able to perform even eventually. So he's easing him slowly into the game. The debut was good, and he scored, the confidence is high.
Mm-hmm.
So bring him in the second half, let him get accustomed,
win
some games, remove pressure from Manchester United, let him come in slowly.
But being a Manchester United player, there will always be pressure.
The pressure is always there. I'd work on that pressure. There's one thing, Eric, we have got to talk about. Martin Keown, the former Arsenal defender, was one of the key players of Brighton last week, Tariq Lamptey. And he says, I've not seen anyone in Europe play as well as Tariq Lamptey so far this season. I'm giggling at things he is doing. He has been phenomenal and is leading the way. How key is Lamptey for Brighton from last weekend's match against Newcastle and coming on to this match?
He is the star player in Brighton, if you look at in terms of all round, because as a football player, you need three major important things. You need the technique, you need the insight, and the good communication, which he has all those three things. And then he has youth on his side and very, very confident. So he's really a key player for them. And if the trend continues, 3, 4, 5 games into the Premier League, him giving those performances, maybe Brighton will not have him in January.
The transfer window ends in the next nine days. So anyway, he reminds me of if you remember Dembele when he came into Tottenham, the way he could glide on the pitch. He has the vision, as you've said, to pick out the key pass. He can still have the pace to run at the ball or with the ball, and also run off the ball, which is something very important for that kid, and also in the position that he's in. Remember something, Brighton is not a big team, okay? But just like Southampton, just like Leicester, but Leicester now has grown in stature because of winning the Premier League, it will produce those lively players that, yes, will be snapped up by the big teams, but it's the impact they make.
Yes.
And for this season, I think he'll be very important for Brighton's progress.
Joe Saina, host of Joe Dunn Football Podcast, here in studio with us, and Eric Aganya, a sports analyst, as we dissect some of the big matches that are coming your way this afternoon here on the Touchline. Another big match. Can it be a 2 out of 2 for Crystal Palace and Everton as they head on to the match today? The Eagles defeated Manchester United in match day 1, 3-1. They are going against Everton, who have actually 2 out of 2 after defeating Tottenham in their first match. They also won their second match by a whooping 5-2. How good is Everton, Eric, when you look at the way Carlo Ancelotti is putting on that team?
The team that is playing on the field is having a great reflection of the coach, a very composed yes. and experienced coach. Mm-hmm. And Everton, on paper and on the field, they are very good. It's a very good team.
Yes.
The same applies to Crystal Palace. They also have a very experienced coach, the oldest actually in the Premier League. So it will be very interesting to see how these two coaches will set up their team. Mm-hmm. But I think, in my opinion, I think Everton have an edge mm-hmm. in terms of now individual players on the pitch who can change the game. They
yes.
have Richarlison. Mm-hmm. They have Calvin Lewin,
yes.
who scored a hat-trick last time. Mm-hmm. They have James Rodriguez.
That is the key player in that midfield.
They have Deco from the one they signed from Watford.
Yes.
So you see that from the midfield going forward, they have very good players. Mm-hmm. Crystal Palace have a tendency to rely so much on Zaha. Mm-hmm. When Zaha doesn't show up on that particular day, then Crystal Palace are in trouble.
Yeah.
Today I'll put my money on Everton.
Everton. I mean, yours, Joe.
When you look at Crystal Palace, when you look at the front three, mm-hmm. let me not disregard the midfield, but if you look at Townsend, mm-hmm. Bashuai, mm-hmm. Zaha.
It's scary.
It screams pace.
Yes.
Screams execution. Mm-hmm. You saw what Zaha did to Manchester United. You saw what Townsend did to Manchester United in terms of bringing in the assists. Now, with Everton, if they're going to play three at the back, they will have a problem. Because the moment the wing-backs, who are going to play also as the wingers at the same time, are not running back, trust me, on one side Zaha, on the other side Townsend, they're going to cause destruction. And then now, Michy Batshuayi is one of the most underrated strikers I've ever seen. Don't also forget there's also Ayew, who mm-hmm. can come in, who last season provided most of the goals for the Crystal Palace. Mm-hmm. So now you're looking at an attacking Crystal Palace under Roy Hodgson, and they believe very well mm-hmm. that they can win these yes. games coming up, because mm-hmm. two on the trot,
yeah.
6 points. You know, of a six points from a possible six points. So
yeah.
you're looking at it as it's just gaining momentum, mm-hmm. gaining momentum, and that's mm-hmm. something that Manchester United need to be wary about, because the last game they played, yes, they were saying that, you know, it was our first game, we were back from training, we were still a bit lethargic, mm-hmm. but now if you don't pick up points today against Brighton, the park will clear very mm-hmm. fast. But for me, Everton, Crystal Palace, I'm looking at a very high draw. Because there would be goals, mm-hmm. for sure.
Eric, you look at, when we're looking at the preview of these matches, since 1934-35 is when Everton won back-to-back games in the season start. But the calmness of the club, for Moshiri to go for Carlo Ancelotti, and Carlo Ancelotti is a Champions League winner, one of the best players the Italy has ever produced, comes on to Everton, and the club is now calm. You don't get a lot of noise or a lot of speculations coming out of that team. Is it that time you'll see Everton coming back even to the David Moyes days, when they were fighting for the European positions?
Yes. This season, I'm really looking at them as fighting for the top six. Reason being, they have an experienced coach with Carlo Ancelotti, mm-hmm. a calming figure. Mm-hmm. And then there's no pressure
yes.
from the club. Mm-hmm. They've been performing. They're comfortable as at the mid-table. Mm-hmm. So anything above the mid-table, above number 10, it's a big plus.
Yes.
There's no pressure on the coach. Mm-hmm. There's no pressure on the team.
Yes.
Then they have a coach again who is able to attract the big names.
Yes.
Because look at Carlo Ancelotti. He has won mm-hmm. the Champions League
yes.
for several times.
Yeah.
I think...
won it twice with AC Milan.
Yes.
Yeah, I think so he did it with Real Madrid.
He's been at Chelsea, he's performed.
Yes.
His track record speaks for him. Mm-hmm. So if he picks up that phone call and makes to a phone call to a player, mm-hmm. the player would like to play for Kalonzo. Yeah.
And those are the players who are going to enjoy the football, because yesterday, yes. Yes. you saw what Rio Ferdinand said at BT Sport. He said that, yes, at Manchester United we won trophies,
yes.
but the pressure was high.
It was high.
At West Ham, it was more of the same. But at Leeds United, yes. it was all about us enjoying. And that is the best, because they got, I think, to the Champions League semi-final. Mm. Mm. And that was the best times you can have as a player.
Yes.
And to have a coach as Carlo Ancelotti on your side, you don't have that, a lot of pressure you for know? Trophies.
Yes.
When you enjoy the game is when also you will perform with the team.
And then the fans.
Yeah.
You saw James said he chose Everton because that is the place where he will be loved. And true,
yes.
he'll not only be loved, he will be idolized.
Yes.
Because of what he will be able to do on that field. You saw a fan coming in and giving him a gift after the game, the first game.
Yes.
So he will give his best to that team. He's really going to enjoy. And many other players who are going to come in.
Yeah.
So I think Everton may be the surprise package this season.
Yeah.
Yes.
We are going on with Crystal Palace there and Everton. We have West Bromwich versus Chelsea today. Are we going to see three loss in a row for West Brom, because now they are going against Chelsea, and Chelsea also needs that win to kickstart the season.
Back in 96,
yeah.
Slaven Bilic played in the same team with Frank Lampard on his own. And he always said the ambition of Frank Lampard
yes.
has been pivotal from West Ham to Chelsea
yeah.
to not becoming the Chelsea manager. Now, he's trying to introduce a new style of football in Chelsea, which is fast-paced.
Yes.
Okay. It's unfortunate for West Brom this afternoon because the organization of Thiago Silva at the back with the likes of Kurt Zouma is very important. They have signed a goalkeeper by the name of Mendy. Who can now give Kepa a run for his money by, you know, showing him that there is competition for this position. Going forward, you're looking at how Kante has been playing. You're looking at how he holds up midfield. Going forward, what Pulisic has been doing. And I'm mentioning to you these players, disregarding even the new recruits.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's what, if you look at that spine
yes.
of Chelsea,
mm-hmm.
and if you look at the players,
mm-hmm.
this is a team that
yeah.
this season is not going for anything less than top three.
Yes.
I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And if Liverpool, let me not even say the big teams, if Man City and Liverpool are not careful,
mm-hmm.
Chelsea is going to take this title.
Yes.
And it starts with a win again today. Mm-hmm. At West Brom. It's unfortunate that West Brom had to face Chelsea now. They're a good team,
mm-hmm.
but unfortunately, I see a Chelsea win.
Yeah. It is the touchline here on Y254 Fan Zone at the moment. I'm Robert Osoro. I'm joined by Eric Aganya, a sports analyst here on Y254, and Joe Saina, who is the host of Joe's Dugout Football Podcast. Time is not on our side, and we cannot talk about all the football games that are there in the English Premier League. But let's go with our remaining 10-15 minutes and talk about La Liga, and specifically talk about Barcelona, because this week, at the end of the day, Luis Suarez has left and he's headed to Atletico Madrid for 5.5 million. Can you believe that? And even Messi came out and said, at this rate, nothing even surprises me anymore at Barcelona. Eric, let me put it to you. Luis Suarez deserved a testimonial match at Barcelona. That is not a way to lose one of your best players.
Luis Suarez has done a lot for Barcelona.
Yeah.
Since the time he left Liverpool for Barcelona.
Mm-hmm.
And the way he's been treated is really a shame to football in general, because
yes.
It's not inspiring to the other players who are still in Barcelona.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you can do this to one of your greatest, what will happen to me who is still giving my best to the team?
Yes.
And I believe Barcelona will come to regret,
mm-hmm.
Because Luis Suarez will punish them.
Yes.
Now that they're in the same league, he will punish them.
Mm-hmm.
And him joining up with, I can't even imagine, him joining up with Diego Costa and Diego Simeone on the touchline.
Yes.
That's fireworks.
Mm-hmm.
But that aside, I think Koeman is being set up to fail from the beginning. Because you are losing influential players
yes.
at a very fast rate,
mm-hmm.
and you're not losing them in a good way. You're
mm-hmm.
losing them in a bad way.
Yes.
It doesn't inspire confidence and morale to the remaining dressing
yes.
team.
And Barcelona will be kicking off the season tomorrow alongside Villarreal, which is coached by former Arsenal coach Unai Emery. And they'll be looking to make an impact on that game as they come. But let's look at some of the problems Barcelona is going to have. Joe, let me start with one from what Eric actually talked about, making the dressing room, having the dressing active and coming on to work. The key question will be, how will Ronald Koeman convince Lionel Messi to be the leader in that dressing room and actually start the season on a high? Because this is a player for, I think, a turbulent 2 months. It has been war between transfers. How is he going to do? How is he going to convince Messi that we can take Barcelona forward?
I believe by changing the playing system. I believe by pushing Messi forward to even be more of a striker and telling me, you know what, not only will you be the captain, you'll be the leader getting the goals. Suarez is gone. We have Coutinho, we have Griezmann. We will put Coutinho and Griezmann on each of your side. You play center. That is the only way you're going to lift up Messi's Messi's attributes in the game. Not only attributes, but also his morale to play for Barcelona. I mean, 3 weeks ago, he was already linked with Manchester City. And Manchester City had a very good offer for him on the table. And the condition was he was going to play alongside Aguero. That even Pep was ready to restructure the formation so that Aguero and Messi can play up front. So I believe that is the key.
Yes.
But if you look at now the spine of the team, and we talk about spines of every team. If you think about Barcelona, you think about Vidal, Piqué, Messi, Suarez, Messi.
Yeah.
Now, the two parts of that backbone has been removed. Yes. What have you replaced them with? You let Arthur go to bring in Pjanic.
Pjanic from Juventus. Yes.
What have you? How Vidal has gone. Vidal is the best utility player you can keep in your team. Yes, he does not start every game. I'm telling you, he'll get in the 65th minute and he'll make a difference in that game. If you need to close out a game so that you don't concede a lot of goals, Arturo Vidal will do that for you. And now the problem is he's gone. PK, you know, Busquets can't do that. PK can do that.
Good that you have brought in the playing units now, because Eric, I was going to put to you now, where are the defenders? Because Barcelona is selling Semedo.
He's gone to Wolves.
And he's a young player who could be there to make that defense. And you remain with Gerard Pique. Umtiti, they are likely also that he's going. He's old. I think Umtiti is 29. Gerard Pique is 32. You've got Jordi Alba, who is also 31. Is that a way to make up your defense?
That is why I'm saying I don't understand, because when Koeman was coming in, I was really excited because he was trying to bring the average playing age down. But you look at their exits, but there are no entries. Because if you're losing, you're supposed to bring in players, players who can replace the players you've left. And as Joe says, there are those players that may not give you the 90 minutes. There are those players that may not give you the week in, week out play, but they're very influential in the dressing room. Arturo Vidal is loud. Arturo Vidal will rally his colleagues and tell them, hey, we are winning this game. You need such kind of players. You're remaining with Busquets, who doesn't talk. He's very good at what he does, but he's not the player who will rally the other players. Look at the defense. Barcelona, naturally, they don't have a very strong defense since time immemorial. But when they don't have a strong defense, they have very good attack. The attack this time is not as good as, it's their worst actually.
Yes.
Because you're talking about a few seasons when we had Thierry Henry and Ronaldinho in one team.
Yes.
That attack is scary, and Messi in one team.
Yes.
Right now, you don't have those players. So the opponents will not fear coming for you.
Yes.
And Koeman is in trouble.
Serious trouble.
He's in trouble.
It is the touchline here on Y254, at Y254 on Facebook. We're actually streaming. Where are you watching us from? We have got some of the reactions of our fans watching from outside there. We've got Raymo Soita watching from Lukome, Bungoma County. Ukinipa tetesi za uamisho, especially zile za Arsenal, itakuwa fresh sana. Arsenal is actually making some good strides. We're going to talk about that. There's a possibility of Torreira moving to Atletico Madrid and Pate coming on to that side. We have got Masinde Evans, Robert Osoram watching live from Soy, and Ronald Juma watching from Kilifi. Some of the people on our Facebook page who are enjoying this one. A man, James, is one fan we have got to bring on to Y254, who is ever a touchline diehard fan watching from Mombasa, and he says Liverpool 2-1. That is the game that will be coming away this weekend for the biggest game of the day. And Liverpool wafanye maneno wasi to disappoint against Arsenal. Let's shift gear. Before we talk about that, let's come back here with Joe and finish off this conversation of La Liga now. Barcelona in disarray. The question will be, as you have rightly put it, other teams will be coming for you. Villarreal now has Unai Emery. Sevilla has Lopetegui. You saw how good they played against Bayern Munich. And how serious they are. Atletico Madrid has really strengthened, and they are also good to play. Real Madrid cannot be left behind. There are times when now the dominance of Barcelona will be put to test. In that, my friend, it's not your time now. Go back to the drawing board and come back with a better team.
I'll make a very good comparison to our favorite team, Manchester United. There is this idea of rebuilding. There is this idea of, you know, we had players. We have the likes of Schweinsteiger. We have the likes of Di Maria.
Yes.
Romelu Falcao was there at some point. Mm-hmm. We are the best players at that point.
Yes.
But again, the rebuilding process started. Mm-hmm. Barcelona has to be ready for that. Mm-hmm. Barcelona has to understand that this season, they might even finish number three.
Yes.
Because the way Real Madrid is going to play, the way Atletico Madrid is going to play, mm-hmm. the way Real Sociedad is going to play with David Silva being there. The way Villarreal, we have talked about, they're going to play.
So yes.
Sevilla, how they played against Bayern Munich and how resilient they are. Mm-hmm. It is a time that Barcelona has to do two things. They either remove the cash in the next 9 days, mm-hmm. so that because the next 9 days, the transfer window will be closed.
Yes.
And get the players that they need. Or they stick with the likes of Ansu Fati, mm-hmm. who signed a new contract with a release clause of, I think, 4 million, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, it was 400 million.
400 million, yes.
Yeah. And say, you know what, we are going to rebuild our team with these young kids. Mm-hmm. The likes of Ricky Coy mm-hmm. in the middle, the likes of Busquets' younger brother who has come back and is also a defensive midfielder.
Yes.
And build with the idea that Messi is going to lead this team mm-hmm. and not conquer Europe, not conquer Spain, but rebuild this team. Because mm-hmm. In the rate they are going, I am saddened if they can meet with Atletico Madrid. Suarez is going to destroy them single-handedly.
Joe Saina, the host of Joe's Dugout Football Podcast here on Y254, and we are still hanging out with Eric Aganya. Now, let's shift gears with our remaining minutes and talk about the biggest match of the weekend. It will be Liverpool versus Arsenal, a repeat of the Community Shield final to win against Liverpool. Let me put it just there. How do you think the match is? As simple as that. And early in the season, that nobody expected this, but we saw Chelsea-Liverpool last weekend. Mm-hmm. It's another big one here. Liverpool-Arsenal.
I think the how it will go, it will depend on the coaches. Mm-hmm. Because remember, they are meeting twice in 1 week.
Yes.
And I believe no coach will be able to win the two games. Mm-hmm. So it will depend on the priorities of the coaches. Mm-hmm. And I believe Arteta would like to beat Liverpool on Monday.
Yes.
So that for two things. Mm-hmm. One, for a statement that, hey, we are coming for the Premier League. We mm-hmm. won the FA League. Yes. It was not by chance.
It was not a fluke that we won it.
We want to make our intention known from the beginning.
Yes.
And then the second one will be to slow down Liverpool. Mm-hmm. Because remember last season, they took off and went.
Yeah.
And
yes.
That was it. Mm-hmm. I would like that to happen. Because if Arsenal is beaten on Monday,
yeah.
then Liverpool may run away with the Premier League early enough.
Yes.
And that is trouble. Mm-hmm. Because Klopp now has the experience mm-hmm. To be able to maintain that momentum until the end.
Yeah.
Arteta, if he prioritizes the Premier League, mm-hmm. then he will beat Liverpool mm-hmm. on Monday
yeah.
and lose on Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
mm-hmm. in the Carabao Cup.
Yes.
Because I don't think he can win, either coach, either manager can yes. win both the two games. Because yeah. We are again seeing in the young managers mm-hmm. are really doing well against the established managers.
Yes.
We saw what Ole Gunnar did to Pep last season. Mm-hmm. We saw what Arteta has been able to do to Klopp.
Yeah.
We saw Lampard beating the known, the big names.
Yes.
So it will be an interesting challenge. But
yeah.
what I believe is that the choice of the coach.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll put my money on Arteta going for the Premier League.
Yeah. Now, in the FA Cup and the Community Shield, there was no Thiago Alcantara. He came on last weekend, 45 minutes, set a new record of the highest passes, I think 75 complete passes in just 45 minutes. Liverpool. If he starts on that midfield, is Arsenal in trouble or not?
They will be in trouble because now that will be, I think, a fourth source of goals.
Uh-huh.
Disregard Firmino's assist to Mane and to Salah. Uh-huh. Disregard the contributions by Trent Alexander-Arnold uh-huh. and Robertson. And now look at what Thiago is going to do.
Uh-huh.
If you give a player like that the opportunity to control the game from the midfield,
yeah.
able to spot Salah, able to spot Mane, able mm-hmm. to spot Firmino, Arsenal are going to be in trouble. And this is because Arsenal are known for pushing their defenders very much ahead.
Yeah.
And that can create a counter-attack. Mm-hmm. At the same time, it can create a possession type of game that the midfield of Arsenal will not be ready to cope and are not ready to cope. Monday's game is critical for Liverpool because Liverpool has done everything needs to do. But now they want to get to the 20 mark. The 20 holy mark that the likes of Manchester United have been chasing. Yeah. The likes of Newcastle have been chasing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking about Blackburn, the teams
mm-hmm.
that have won the Premier League before. Arsenal
yes. mm-hmm.
and the Invincibles.
Yeah.
So now he wants to prove a point that he's going to make Liverpool the most prestigious team in the United Kingdom.
Yes. So
how is he going to do that? He's going to go for this year's Premier League again.
Yeah,
but to my pundit's point,
yeah.
my fellow pundit's point,
yeah.
Arsenal has to slow down Liverpool.
Yeah.
It's not going to be Chelsea to slow down Liverpool, I can
mm-hmm.
tell you now.
Yeah.
It's not even going to be Man City or Man United.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be Arsenal. Because yeah. Arsenal has introduced that fast-paced game mm-hmm. that we used to marvel.
Yes. Yeah.
And as he says, Thiago Alcantara is bringing something different to Liverpool. We've known Liverpool to be a threat when the wing backs come forward.
Yes.
And they've been playing long balls.
Mm-hmm.
Thiago Alcantara, if you looked at the Chelsea game, when he came in, he confused the whole of the Chelsea team.
Yes.
Because now they are not bringing those long balls.
Mm-hmm.
He takes the short passes
now through the midfield. Coming through the midfield.
Through the midfield.
Yeah.
And he has given them another outlet.
Mm-hmm.
And another dimension of the whole team.
Yes.
And it will be really interesting to see how Arsenal will be able to handle that on Monday.
And it actually reminds me, sorry for interjecting, yes, it actually reminds me of the Barcelona-Real Madrid game. I think it was in 2012 or 2011.
Yes.
Where they were walloped 5-0.
Mm-hmm.
No, was it 5-0 or was it 7-0 mm-hmm. by Barcelona?
Yes.
And the idea of playing the passing game from the midfield
mm-hmm.
to the attacking, what Xavi and Iniesta could do, is something that Thiago can introduce to the likes of Henderson, to the likes of Gigi, to the likes of Milner also, and Naby Keita. I believe that assimilation can happen.
Let's leave it at there. 22 minutes gone in the game, 27 in the game between Brighton and Manchester United, 0-0 at the moment. Bruno Fernandes had a yellow card on the 22nd.
He wasn't given a penalty.
No. Do you expect a win, Brighton United?
I expect a tough game for Manchester United.
Yeah,
but they will walk off with the points.
Eric?
Definitely Manchester United.
One question I'll have to ask you next week will be I never had time to talk about is the impact of the fans, because Manchester United is a team that is known to rally behind the fans to actually perform. Liverpool the same, and without fans, it's a big one for Manchester United. That's where we finish off here on the Touchline today. Some of the other matches that will be coming your way, we've got Crystal Palace versus Everton, West Brom, Chelsea will be coming away, then Burnley versus Southampton. In La Liga, it's halftime between Alaves and Getafe. Valencia and Huesca will be at 5. Elche and Real Sociedad at 7:30. And then at 10 p.m. will be Betis playing home to Real Madrid. That's where we finish off here on the Touchline. Good afternoon. Enjoy the rest of your viewing and follow us on all our social media platforms.